investment group investee Paraytec has completed proof of concept trials for a coronavirus test that is being developed with the University of Sheffield. So that brings me on to our guest here who is dealing with this concept. It is Professor Carl Smythe. Hello to you, Carl.
Hello. Hello, Katie.
Very warm welcome to Proactive. I know you're a very busy man because you're going to tell us about this technology in Paraytec, the test itself. How does it differ from other tests that are out there? Because it's very competitive.
You're right. It is a very competitive area at the moment. It's probably worth saying that there will be a huge need for a wide variety of types of tests. Okay. However, the way in which this test distinguishes itself from the other offerings that are emerging or are already out in the market is related to a number of issues. One is that it detects, or it will detect, what we refer to as intact virus. So the current ways in which people are tested to establish whether they're infected is to extract out from a virus, from a sample, bits of the virus, biological molecules, which are used to establish whether or not they're there or not. Whereas what we plan to do is to detect an intact virus. And that's really important from the point of view of infectivity, because we know, for example, that in people who have the disease but may not be infectious anymore, the tests that are currently available show that they're positive because fragments of virus stay around in the system for quite some time but are not necessarily infectious. If we have an intact virus, then of course it will be infectious. So that's one aspect of our test that will be distinct. Mm-hmm. The other two things are that it will be very fast. It needs to be fast so that people can know quickly whether or not they're infected or not, and that organizations can act appropriately, whether it's at an airport or at a football field or in a hospital, for example. Whoever's conducting the test needs to know reasonably quickly, much less than the 24-hour turnaround, for example, of a polymerase chain reaction test, that one is dealing with somebody who is positive for the virus and that they can be advised appropriately and they should act appropriately and the contact tracing can go ahead. And it's also important that our test will be very, very sensitive by comparison to other available tests. So the notion that different people will have different amounts of virus in a sample, perhaps it's a saliva sample or a nasal swab. We are hoping that we expect our tests to be very sensitive, detecting people before they are symptomatic and well after they are symptomatic. So being very inclusive in finding all the people who might be infectious is mm-hmm. broadly the unique selling points, if that's the right word, phrase of our test.
Yeah. What does it mean to have gained proof of concept?
Well, quite simply, this is where you take the particular design, the approach that we are using scientifically to capture virus and make it visible and demonstrate that that actually works. So there is a lot of theory, biological theory, behind the approach that we took. However, proof of concept is where one actually does those experiments. One isolates material that mimics a virus, shows that part of our approach has to deal with the fact that the actual number of virus particles in a sample is actually very small at a molecular level. And therefore, it's quite hard to find it. So we needed to have a way of enriching the sample for the virus particles and removing all the things that you don't want to know about or don't want to see. Mm-hmm. And then we needed to have a way of making that visible so that some kind of light detector would be able to see the virus, so to speak. So putting those steps together so that we could show that we can enrich and label and for a detector to be able to detect the now illuminated virus was what proof of concept was about. And that's what we have now achieved.
Tell us about the next steps in the development of the test.
there are a number of next steps, but from our perspective, from the basic science of this, what we will be doing is, first of all, maximizing both the speed of the test and the sensitivity of the test. So there are many biological tricks that we can quickly apply to the basic principle to speed up just how quickly we can, for example, enrich the virus from the biological sample and make it detectable to the system that's detecting it. Following that, of course, the next step after that is using clinical samples. So going and getting very real samples from people who are known to have had coronavirus and establishing how well this test is performing against samples that we know what the level of virus was in positive and indeed negative samples, so that we can continue to improve and optimize our test with respect to what is currently done.
And when would you expect the test to be available to use?
So there are a number of significant number of steps involved in obtaining regulatory approval for the test. And that will require a number of months of work. But realistically, I think, you know, in early spring, there should be something, an offering, which is a fairly impressive rate of progress from something that we started with a blank sheet of paper about 4 months ago.
And what about the price? Is it likely to be expensive?
Well, there are two aspects to this. One would be the detector device itself, and the market I think initially being aimed for would be places like hospitals, perhaps theatres, airports, and so on. And there will probably be a price associated with that, would be significantly less than the kind of equivalent device that's used in a laboratory setting. So the price of the test per sample will have to be competitive with established testing regimes. So I don't see at the moment that the costs that we're likely to need to factor in are likely to make it significantly expensive. So the idea would be to be comparable with existing tests.
And do you think this technology has the potential to be used for other viral diseases?
Well, Katie, I'm glad you asked that question. And the answer is yes. So one of the advantages, for example, that we think our test will have compared, for example, to a test that emerged in the media over the last week, is that it is tailored to be really quite specific for the COVID-19 virus. And that's really very important, as you can imagine, as people wish to know with what they are infected and if indeed they have this particular disease. It follows that the core underlying technology that we are developing can be applied to other types of viruses, but not just viruses. So any kind of pathogenic organism, any kind of organism that infects people, in principle, can be detected this way, and not just actually that kind of pathology. There are other kinds of pathologies that the test could also be applied to, including things like cancer. So we're looking in the longer term to developing the technology to be a very sensitive platform for specific tests for a wide variety of states of illness.
Professor Carl Smythe, thank you very much indeed talking to us here on Proactive London from the University of Sheffield.
Thanks very much, Katie.